Well, students, in this lecture we are going to study about the construction and working of the helium neon laser. Helium neon laser is also called a gas laser because here the active medium, that is the medium in which light amplification takes place, is a gas. It's a mixture of helium and neon gas. So what does a helium neon laser consist of? It consists of a long discharge tube. It's basically a glass tube which is about 50 centimeters in length and only 1 centimeter in diameter, and this tube is filled with a mixture of helium and neon gas in the ratio 10:1. So meaning for every 10 helium atoms there is only 1 neon atom. End of the tubes there are two mirrors which are placed. One mirror is 50% reflecting while the other mirror is 100% reflecting. Both these mirrors constitute the mirrors of the optical resonator. Next, what is there is to the tube there are two electrodes which are attached, positive anode and negative cathode, across which a high voltage is connected, and this gas is there in a tube which is made of quartz. Now the helium neon laser, just like the ruby laser, also gives out a red color laser light, but the wavelength is different. The wavelength here in the case of helium neon laser is 6,328 Armstrong units. Now, what is the working of this helium neon laser? The working is slightly lengthy and complicated, so I will do it step by step. Now, what happens is, when you initially switch on this power supply, high voltage supply, some of the atoms in this helium neon gas mixture, they get ionized. Now, what is the meaning of this? Now, we know that any atom, whether it is helium or neon or rather any atom, the net charge on it is zero. Okay, total charge is zero. But when we supply energy to this atom in the form of heat or electricity or mechanical whatever, in the case of helium neon laser, we are supplying energy in the form of electricity, high voltage. So when we supply energy to an atom, electrons from the outer orbits, you can remove them out. Okay, so when an electron from the outer orbit is removed, we have a negative electron, free electron, and what is left behind is a positively charged ion. So this is called as ionization. So for ionization, you need to supply energy to the atom. So in this case, we supply energy in the form of the high voltage. Now, what happens next is that, so we have these two electrodes, anode, positive anode and negative cathode, across which a high voltage is applied. And because of this high voltage, the atoms, some of the helium and neon atoms in the gas mixture, they get ionized. So electrons, negative electrons and positive ions are created. Now the electrons will start moving towards the positive terminal, that's the anode. Whereas the ions, positive ions, will start moving towards the negative cathode. Now, since electrons are lighter than the ions, ions are heavier, the electrons will gain a very high speed. They will start moving very fast. Ions also will move, but their speed will be less. So, electrons start gaining very high speed. Now, these high speed electrons, as they are moving towards the anode, they will collide in their path with helium and neon atoms in the tube. So, electrons will collide with helium and neon atoms. And now, during the collisions, so electrons are colliding with helium, electrons are colliding with also neon. When electron collides with helium, the helium atoms pick up the energy from the electrons, fast-moving electrons, and they get excited. This does not happen with neon. When electron collides with neon, energy from electron does not get transferred to neon. Why is it so that only helium atoms can take up energy from the electrons and neon atoms cannot take up energy? This follows from the theory of collisions. We know that between any two colliding bodies, energy transfer during the collision can take place only if the masses of the two colliding bodies are comparable. Now, here electron is a light particle. Now, helium atom also is a light atom. Its atomic number is only 2. It's a very light gas. Okay. So, when electron and helium collide, they are like comparable masses colliding. So, energy transfer from electron to helium can take place. Neon, on the other hand, is atomic number 10. It's a very heavy atom. So, electron is a light particle. Helium is a heavy atom. So, when electron collides with neon, energy transfer between electron and neon is almost not possible because neon is a very heavy atom. So, electron colliding with helium, helium gets excited from the ground state to the upper levels, which is shown in this energy level diagram. So, which is shown here. So, this part of the energy level diagram here, this side, left side, is helium energy level diagram. This side energy level diagram is of neon. So, what we see here, helium from the ground state F1 gets excited either to the level F2 or F3. How? by colliding with electrons. So when helium collides with fast moving electrons, helium takes up the energy from the electrons and they get excited either to the level F2 or F3 depending upon the energy of the electron. If the electron had higher energy, it will get excited to the level F3. If the electron colliding electron had lesser energy, the helium atom will get excited to the level F2. Now F2 and F3 both are metastable. So helium atoms will tend to remain over in these levels for a very long time. So these excited helium atoms now, as they are moving through the gas mixture, they may collide with the neon atoms. Okay, neon atoms. And when excited helium atoms collide with the neon atoms, they transfer, the helium atoms transfer their energy to the neon atoms. Okay, so in the process what happens? Helium goes back to the ground state and neon from the ground state E1 gets excited to the level either E6 or E4. Now if you see these levels E6 and E4, they are almost exactly coinciding with the levels F3 and F2 in helium. So E6 almost coincides with the level F3, and E4 in neon coincides almost with the level F2 in helium. Now because of this matching energy levels, E6 matching with F3 and E4 matching with F2, when helium collides with neon, this energy transfer between helium to neon is possible. It is only because of this matching energy level. So it's only the helium and neon gas mixture which works in producing a laser. Any other gas combination does not work. Why? Because there are no matching energy levels between the two gas combinations. Only helium and neon have this exactly matching energy levels, E6 with F3 and E4 with F2. So now, if a helium atom in the which helium excited atom was in the level F3 before collision, then this helium atom in the level F3, when it collides with neon, it will transfer the energy to the neon, and neon from E1 will get excited to the level E6. If before collision the helium atom was in level F2, then during the collision between helium and neon, the helium will transfer energy to the neon, and neon from ground state will get excited to the level E4. So depending upon which level the helium atom was in, either F2 or F3, correspondingly after collision with the neon, neon gets excited either to the level E6 or E4. So this is how neon atom gets excited. So neon does not get excited directly from the high voltage, but it is the helium which first gets excited, and then helium collides with neon and transfers the energy to the neon, and neon then gets excited. Okay, so now E6 and E4 in neon are metastable, so atoms in these levels can remain for a long time. Now there are other levels here, E5 and E3, which are not metastable, they are normal excited states. So atoms cannot remain in these levels for a long time. Even if by chance they reach into these levels, atoms over here will not remain over here for long. So there is collection of atoms in level E6 and in level E4. So what will happen is, very soon there will be more atoms in E6 compared to E5. There will be more atoms in E6 compared to E3, and also there will be more atoms in E4 compared to E3. So there will be three population inversions taking place. Now population inversion always takes place between a upper metastable state and a lower non-metastable state. So in the neon energy levels, there are three such combinations which are possible. E6 is a upper metastable state and E5 is a lower non-metastable state. So population inversion between these two is possible. Similarly, E6 is a metastable state and E3 is a non-metastable state. So again, population inversion between these two, E6 and E3, is easily possible. And similarly, E4 is a metastable state, upper metastable state, and E3 is a lower non-metastable state. So again, population inversion between E4 and E3 is easily possible. So three population inversions are possible. So now, once the population inversion between these three population inversions takes place, immediately the laser action starts. So three lasers are actually emitted by the neon atoms. Okay, so three laser transitions are possible here because there are three population inversions which are taking place. First one is E6 to E5 transition, which gives rise to a laser having a wavelength 33,900 Armstrong units, which is a very large wavelength. This wavelength is not a visible wavelength. It is a far infrared wavelength. It's not a visible laser. Though it's a laser light, it's not visible because its wavelength is very large. The second laser is from E6 to E3, the second population inversion, E6, E3 combination. Now, transition from here to here gives rise to a laser which is red in color. Okay, so this is the visible laser. Then the third population inversion, E4 and E3, gives rise to a laser transition having a wavelength again which is beyond the visible region, 11,500 Armstrong units. Visible region is from 4,000 to 8,000 Armstrong units. So anything more than 8,000 is infrared. So this one and this one are not visible lasers, whereas only this one is the visible laser. So when we talk about neon laser, it is this laser which we talk about. red color laser having a wavelength of 6320 Armstrong units. Okay, so three lasers are created. Now, because of the laser transitions, atoms are brought from E6 to E5, E6 to E3, or E4 to E3. Now, E5 and E3 are non-metastable states. They can, atoms which are brought down to these levels through laser transitions cannot remain over here for long. So what happens to them? Atoms which are brought down into this level E5 or this level E3, they quickly undergo spontaneous transitions to the level E2, which is a metastable state. So which is this spontaneous transitions are shown by this straight arrows, thin straight arrows. Laser transitions are shown by thick straight arrows. Now, so spontaneous transitions to the level E2 takes place from E5 and E3. Now E2 is metastable. Now what will happen is atoms will tend to get accumulated in this level. Now this is disadvantageous for us. If atoms get accumulated in the level E2, what will happen? Number of atoms here will decrease, because when number of atoms in this in any particular level start increasing, the atoms in the ground state will decrease, because the total number of atoms in the system are constant. So when atoms over here start accumulating, here the number of atoms will decrease. Now that's a problem. If atoms over here start, number of atoms here start decreasing, then the number of atoms which will be lifted up to the levels E6 and E4 will also decrease, because E6 and E4, where do they get the atoms from? From the ground state. So if ground state atoms are decreasing in number, then number of atoms being lifted to the E6 and E4 levels will decrease, and that will result in less laser output. So laser output will keep on decreasing if atoms over here start accumulating. So we do not want atoms to accumulate over here. So we want to quickly bring them down to the ground state so that they are available again to go up to the level E6 and E4, so that the laser transitions will continue. Now how do we, even though E2 is metastable, how do we quickly bring them down to the ground state? So this is done by de-excitation by collision with the walls of the discharge tube. If you remember, the discharge tube, the walls are very thin. Only once the discharge tube has a thickness of only 1 centimeter. So what happens is, these E2 atoms, E2 neon atoms, which are in the metastable state, they are quickly brought down to the ground state. How? By colliding with the walls of the discharge tube. So when the excited E2 neon atoms in the level E2 collide with the walls of the discharge tube, they transfer the energy to the walls, and in the process, they come down to the ground state. So that's the reason why the wall is made very thin. The discharge tube is made very thin, only 1 centimeter in thickness, so that the probability of the collisions by the neon atoms in the level E2 with the walls is higher. So when the tube is very thin, immediately the atoms can collide with the walls and transfer the energy to the walls, and in the process they come down. So then the cycle continues. Atoms are brought down to the ground state, again they are taken up to the level E6 and E4 by collision with the helium atoms, and the process of laser keeps on continuing. So helium neon laser therefore gives out a continuous laser output. The laser output never stops in between. Why? Because this is a continuous cycle. Atoms are taken up, they are again brought down, and again by collision with helium atoms, again they get excited, and this process keeps on continuing, and the laser keeps on continuing. Okay, so that is how so that's the advantage of helium neon laser. So helium neon laser has three advantages. Since it uses a four-level, important thing I forgot to mention earlier, helium neon laser uses a four-level pumping scheme. Now, why do we say this is a four-level pumping scheme? There are six energy levels. So, why do we say it's a four-level pumping scheme? Remember, pumping scheme can be either be three-level or four-level. It is called three-level if the laser transitions end on the ground state. If you see the ruby laser, the laser transition was ending on the ground state. So, that's why in the ruby laser, it's a three-level pumping scheme. Whereas in a helium neon laser, none of the laser transitions are ending on the ground state, even. So, this is called four level. If the laser transitions are not ending on the ground state, we call it as a four level pumping scheme. So, pumping scheme either be three level or four level. There is nothing called as five level or six level. So, helium neon laser utilizes the three level pumping scheme because none of the laser transitions end on the ground state. Okay. So, since it uses the four level pumping scheme, it requires less pumping energy. That's the advantage of the four level pumping scheme. So, this is the advantage of the helium neon laser. It requires less pumping power. Okay, so second advantage is that its efficiency is higher. There is no heat loss over here. Whatever energy is supplied by the high voltage, almost the entire energy is utilized in the laser. So there is no heat loss. And so efficiency is high. And the third is the laser output is continuous. Okay, so because continuously atoms are taken up and the laser output keeps on going on. So these are the advantages of helium neon laser compared to the ruby laser. Okay, so I hope you understood the working of this helium neon laser. It's slightly lengthy and complicated, but I tried to make it as simple as possible. So, thank you. And with this, we end the chapter on lasers.